Hi, Mahua. Let me also just ask Faye to join.
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, so please, I'll just get out of this screen now, and please take this conversation forward. We are all so excited for you to be here with us. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Apar. For our audience who've joined in, welcome to this conversation. It's one that I've personally been looking forward to. In fact, since Mahua Moitra joined politics and was elected Member of Parliament, I've been looking forward to have a conversation with her. So I'm really glad that we get to do this today. I'm sure most of you know who Ms. Moitra is. She's a parliamentarian in the 17th Lok Sabha. And a former investment banker who quit a plush job in London, I understand, to get, to roll up her sleeves and get into Indian politics. And she really has sort of made her presence felt, especially on many, many topics, but especially to do with privacy. Two particular things that come to mind. One, the PIL that she filed before the Supreme Court on the government's inviting tenders from the Information Broadcast Ministry to ask private parties to come up with a tool so that the government can actually look through social media and figure out who's saying what. Also, she's asked many questions in Parliament about the Personal Data Protection Bill that's basically in cold storage as far as the government is concerned. So great time today on this anniversary to have a conversation with Ms. Moitra. Good evening and thank you for joining. It's a pleasure to have this conversation with you.
Thank you, Faye. I'm very glad that you're doing this. And I know you're very busy, but thank you for doing this. Thank you.
My first question to you is about that data protection bill that we were supposed to have. And I remember talking about this while we were doing shows about Aadhaar, because first the government argued that we have no privacy, that it's not a thing. This is a figment of our imagination. And then there was a lot of talk about, no, you know, there will be a privacy bill that will come, don't worry about it. But it doesn't seem to be on the list of this government's priorities at all. From someone who's inside Parliament, do you think it's going to be a fairly long wait? What is your assessment?
Faye, this has been in the public domain for a long time, that we're going to get a PDP bill, that they have invited people to come and speak on this. When I joined Parliament, for example, which was in June of last year, 2019, they said that we've had a consultation, it's online, and I raised a question in Zero Hour, and I got my party. Trinamool was one of the first people that did a demonstration outside Parliament in front of the Gandhi statue on that we need a data protection bill. Because then what was happening is the UFPA and the NIA and all sorts of other legislation were being passed through. The DNA bill was being passed through. So our point was, if you are pushing through such legislation and the ruling party with its majority today can actually force through everything, we are just... basically, there is not even a rubber stamp. So we said, given we don't have a PDP act in place, given that the bill hasn't become an act, if you are rushing through things like DNA legislation without deciding on who owns the DNA. Do I own my blood? Do I own my DNA? To what extent does the state have access to it? If I'm a convict, does the state have access to my DNA for forensics to see if I've committed a murder? But can they take it from me if its offense is less than 7 years, which is what the DNA bill said? And when you're dealing with police in our country where so many excesses are done, what is there? What are the checks and balances to show that if a person who was picking someone's pocket has been brought into the police station and his blood is not taken for DNA, right? So we said all this kind of legislation in the absence of a strong personal data protection bill is very premature, and we are putting the cart before the horse, which is what we had said. We said we need this. In fact, I got a letter from Ravi Shankar Prasad, our law minister, who's also IT minister, last week, saying that we've put it in place. After that, we pushed for this to come to standing committee. Because the standing committee was chaired by Dr. Shashi Tharoor, who is part of the opposition, they gave us a JPC. I am actually on the Joint Parliamentary Committee. We only had two sittings before the lockdown. After the lockdown, we have had four or five rushed sittings, which I have not been able to join because of COVID, our party standards that we couldn't attend meetings. And I've only attended this last parliamentary standing committee meeting. So now we are starting. So I have actually missed out on 203 PDP JPC meetings, which have been pretty much full of the BJP people. So yes, the question, especially on medical data, on transparency, and on the PDP bill's general mood is that, listen, privacy is something we're giving you as a favor. It's not that this government is very far removed from the basic idea that privacy is something that is fundamental to your being. They're treating privacy as a luxury. And, you know, so it is up to the government, given I heard the speaker, I think Mr. Manzar speaking before me, that a lady had no access to her bank account. I see this all the time. I work in the rural areas. And when we try and tell people, don't give your Aadhaar number, don't go for Aadhaar, don't sign up for Aarogya Setu, they don't get it. They just don't get it because privacy is not something Indians have ever sort of treated as a valuable commodity, right? So there is a great divide between the rich and the poor, between the educated and the uneducated. And it is the government's policy, and we have Vinda Govar, I see, who's listening in, and Vinda's fought for this, as have a lot of lawyers in the Supreme Court, is that the government has to act as the parent. The government has to act as the guardian. And the government is failing in its responsibility to look out for privacy for the millions and millions of people who either don't understand or are not empowered enough to stand up for themselves. So I think that's the very big gap between, even when the bill becomes an act and in whatever form, if your basic idea is that this is something that we are just doing because we need to do, and this is not something that we are doing, like, for example, Europe or the UK is doing, which is that fundamental privacy is a fundamental right, we need to enforce this to become a better government. I think that is the big question, the big divide in India today.
You know, you did mention the Aarogya Setu app, and there were a lot of questions that were raised about the fact that it is the most intrusive tracker app that has been created in COVID times. And again, there's this whole point of what is your priority? The government's response to us as media was, do you want us to fight COVID or do you want your privacy? And you have something to hide? Is that why you want your privacy? What do you think is most important? And that is the basis of the argument they've presented with Aadhaar, they presented it with the health card, they presented it with
every dictatorial majoritarian regime ever since time immemorial has used that excuse, Faye. You know it. Everyone listening to this probably know it. The two are not mutually exclusive. Just because I need care during a pandemic doesn't mean I've got to give up every right that is fundamentally guaranteed to me by the Constitution. This is a very fundamental truth that all of us have to understand and fight for. And this question is a black and white question. When someone says, would you rather have this or that, it is not fundamentally or mutually exclusive. When people in the villages ask me this, that, oh, this is how they're explaining it, I use one example. I say, well, if someone asks me to choose between your wife and your mother, is it fair that you should have to do that? Right? Because you need to make people understand you don't need to give up one to love the other more. Right? So I think whether it is all up to all of us to make people understand, as far as the Aarogya Setu is concerned, and this is something I'm speaking from personal experience, I don't have the Aarogya Setu. I spoke up against it. There was nothing in law that forced us to have it. It is not mandatory, which is what even the Karnataka High Court has said the other day, if you remember, right? It is not mandatory, but the problem is in our country, no one questions authority. So if they just say, show us this, most people show you that. Whereas I have gone into an airport, I have taken a train, and they have asked me, where's the Aarogya Setu app? I said, I don't have it. It is not mandatory. Do not stop me. And I've got in. Now, people can say, oh, you're an MP. That's why you get in. I don't travel with people. I'm traveling in mufti, in normal clothes. I don't even think people know, frankly, when I'm telling them. So I think people just need to be aware. This is not mandatory. You don't need to have this. And that's the way it is. What if somebody...
This is the argument again. The Supreme Court had made it very clear that Aadhaar, for example, is not to be mandatory.
Yes.
But the government then said, in order to file your tax returns, you have to link your Aadhaar, which means you have to have an Aadhaar in order to file your tax returns. If you don't file your tax returns, you're breaking the law. So they basically made it optional but compulsory in some weird way.
I went to
court down this route again.
Yeah, yes. I think they're going down the route again. We have to fight it. If you remember, I was one of the petitioners in Aadhaar against the bank account linkage, right? So we said, if you've got your PMLA, they use PMLA as an example. We said, in PMLA, you're innocent till proven guilty. So till I'm on a list of people that you might think I have a Swiss account, and then you want to look up my bank details via Aadhaar, sure. But till such time, you have no right to do it. And we actually won because on my petition is that they said that you there's not mandatory linkage. After that, in Parliament, this went on. They amended the Aadhaar Act, if you remember, and they brought this in. They amended the Aadhaar Act and said that you can bring in IT and all that. But even then, they've given us a time limit. I don't think it is still mandatory for IT. They've said that, but I don't think it is. So the thing is that we have to keep going to court. We have to keep going to court because this government, we had on the social media tendering, it was on a Thursday or Friday, the Attorney General, Mr. Venugopal, was standing up on behalf of the government and saying, we withdraw this. BSIL was withdrawing this. On the very same day, the UIDAI, the Aadhaar Authority, was opening bids for a new tender, exactly the same, floated by a different authority. So they keep trying every door, every window. We have to be vigilant and we have to keep fighting. And I know it's very difficult, but it's up to us for programs like this, for anchors, for media, for public representatives to explain to people, question authority, don't just do what you have, what they tell you to do, because that way there'll be nothing left.
Well, in recent times, of course, there was that whole conversation about whether Facebook in India is leaning towards the ruling party for various reasons. Now, if we piece these three things together, one, the absence of a personal data protection bill. Second, the combination of Facebook, Instagram and WhatsApp having a considerable influence over the general population. And three, the understanding that they might be leaning towards a certain party in order to just make business easier. What peril does that put the democracy and elections under in your mind?
Yeah, this is obviously very dangerous. I had spoken about this in Parliament and in many other forums, saying that the last election was fought on fake news and WhatsApp. And I've stood up in Parliament and said this, that this was a WhatsApp election. The election strategy is WhatsApp and fake news. And by repeating something, people in our country, again, if they see something in print, they believe it to be true. If they see something on WhatsApp, I've had educated people, not only in my area, all over, who read this. I mean, even my mother, she'll look at something she receives on WhatsApp. Have you seen this? I said, Mommy, it's rubbish. She said, oh no, but someone sent it to me. You know, so this is so widespread that people think that whatever they receive on WhatsApp is gospel truth, especially in villages where people are buying smartphones for the first time. And WhatsApp has really caught on as this big medium of communication, and it's really very widely used. So this is a election strategy. We had the Honorable Home Minister, Mr. Amit Shah, in a meeting come out and say, what do you want to know? I can make people believe anything. You give me any truth, I can feed it to people. So if that's your election strategy, and then you've got very compliant Facebook and WhatsApp management structure in India, which is bending over backwards. I mean, we've called Facebook for a deposition, for deposing before us in the IT Standing Committee on the 2nd. And you have seen this. You have seen the Guardian report. We have seen it ourselves. Like I said, that inside Parliament, in the premises of Parliament, we have the Indian public policy head of Facebook doing a training for women MPs. Why do women MPs need special technology training? I fail to know. Is it that we're dumber than the rest of them? And B, this is Parliament, where no foreign company is allowed anywhere near technology. NIC does everything. Who invited Facebook to come in, brand the entire Parliament House annex room and do this? So they're obviously in with the government. We've seen this over and over again, that they don't take down content. There's a big fiasco right now in the US as well, with some whistleblowers within Facebook who have said that Facebook has been very pro-right, even in the US. And this is something that is really blowing up in their face. Let's wait for the 2nd. But yes, this is a very dangerous combination where Facebook and WhatsApp control as much of the market as they do. You have a government that is manufacturing fake content and Facebook is helping them disseminate it. And then on the other hand, you have a weak legal infrastructure and a weak Data Protection Act, or the absence of a total absence so far. So the combination of all three means that there is absolutely no recourse for individuals.
I must ask you a very basic question, if I may, please. When we talk about the health cards, Aadhaar, Jandan, all of the details of individuals that the government has so far collected, now add to that the Aarogya Setu app. For someone in rural India, and you did say that you, and I know that you've been traveling through your constituency a lot through this lockdown as well. For someone in rural India, their concerns are going to be work, food, keeping their family in clothing and well-fed and in school. They're going to turn around and say, you know what, I don't even understand what privacy is. I don't really care. I'm one among a billion people. Take it. It's fine. As long as I, you know, I get food, I get ration, it's fine.
Absolutely.
How do you battle that? How do you convince them otherwise?
That's what I said. When we said, don't give your Aadhaar card for mobile linkage, they said, oh, but Jio is giving us free data in the villages. Jio has put in fiber cables. They're giving us free data. Airtel, Vodafone are expensive. And Jio says Aadhaar is mandatory. So we don't care. We give them the Aadhaar because we want free data and we want, and I can't blame them. If Jio is giving them for 30 rupees, as much data and as much free calling, why would they not give their Aadhaar card? They don't know the value of this. And they say, we have nothing. So what if
we should not forget the fact that Facebook has invested heavily in Jio as well. So
that's recent as well. Yeah, that's new. But this is even before that. The idea that, this is very important. People in India, the poor in India, don't value themselves. They don't think that I have value as a consumer. The Indian public is empowered to think of themselves as I have value as a voter. So before a vote, they'll say, if you don't do this, we'll remove you. That they've understood, and they've understood for a long time. They want accountability. But when it comes to viewing themselves as a consumer, when it comes to viewing themselves that, look, my data, my personal data, even though I'm a poor person in a village, barely eating three meals, my personal data could be of use to somebody. This idea is alien to them. Because they don't value themselves and their personal data, they don't think anybody else can have value for it. So they are free with it. They don't care. And that's when I said that the government has to come in as be the guardian for all these people rather than consume their data and make money on it.
There is the danger of the government being the guardian and the government also then becoming a parent who tells you what you can and cannot have. Yeah. And, you know, what's not necessary. That might also be the case. Are we running, we're risking crossing over into that, turning from citizens into subjects?
Space. Yeah, I think we've crossed that line a long time ago. We've crossed that line a very long time ago. And today, sitting in opposition, I really feel that every minute people says, why don't you do anything? What can you do? You tell me this. When you're sitting in parliament, and they have the numbers in the Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha now to ram every piece of legislation through. They have used this pandemic to put through every ordinance possible. Right? So there's no discussion. When there is no legislative oversight, and the courts have completely failed in their duty, completely failed. I mean, I'm sorry, it is shameful that if citizens like you, normal citizens today stand up and went at the back of a judgment. Before, when we would go to the Supreme Court and the judgment went against us, we would say, you know, the court said this, we respect it. Today, when a judgment comes out against somebody, the first thing that enters people's mind is, where is this judge? Where is his background? Was he in Gujarat? Is he going to go to the Rajya Sabha? Is he hankering for governor of Maharashtra after this? Is he hankering for NCLT chairman after this? Is this not shameful? So you see, when the perception of the judiciary is compromised, whether the judiciary is compromised or not is secondary. When the perception of the judiciary is compromised to this extent, then people just, and you have such a majority in parliament, then what are your checks and balances? That is why we've all become subjects. We've all become, you and I can shout and scream, what can you do?
That was going to be my next question, because you did say, of course, that, you know, opposition barely has any say right now in parliament. So you said that you've knocked on the doors of the court repeatedly. You have yourself taken up the eye of the Supreme Court, like you pointed out. But if that, according to you, is also a fading option, then as civil society, what options do we have?
As civil society, all we can do is we can do what we are doing, which is, it doesn't stop me speaking in parliament, it doesn't stop me pointing it out, and it doesn't stop you from having these discussions, doesn't stop you from writing. Even though our ability and the platform that we get to voice our views is small, it is heard. It is heard. The fact that I'm sitting here as an elected MP, the fact that you are conducting this show, the fact that there are 10 people listening to it is itself a positive sign, right? So I think that we just have to keep continuing to do this. And sooner or later, I believe that democracy or people will realize that their sense of democracy in India is being compromised and there will be a pushback. It's just a question of when. It may take 2 years, it may take 5 years, but I am confident it will happen. And we must, at that time, our children will be able to look and tell us that, you know what, we were on the right side of the divide. And that's very important to do.
There's a question. I'm just going to take one that's coming from Sharma, who says, I'm in Jammu. 4G internet has been banned for the last 1 year. Students are having trouble studying online. And, you know, in connection to the fact that we're talking about data and access to the internet and privacy, do you believe that the cutting off of data and internet in Kashmir was also, and Jammu and Kashmir was also a way to sort of take away rights and to control opinions?
Of course, it's curbing dissent. I mean, last week in the committee, we had in the IT camp committee, this cutting off in internet was on the agenda. I can't discuss committee proceedings, but this was very much brought up on the agenda. And the fact that the problem is that when you are cutting off internet, the rules surrounding this is something that the IT department has promised according to the January 2020, this went to the Supreme Court. Supreme Court said when you are shutting off internet, there has to be, you can only do it for a X amount of time. There is no outer limit right now. So what they keep doing is anyone which is a SDO level person can go on, any joint secretary person can go signing this saying that 15 days, then another 15 days, then another 15 days. There's no review process. And the review process is the executive looks after the executive. So the state home secretary will issue this, and the review consists of the state law secretary and the state chief secretary. If the government is in power with state chief secretary and with state law secretary, is going to go against the orders of the state home secretary, right? Same in national level, cabinet secretary and law secretary will oversee something that the home secretary has issued. So A, this oversight mechanism is not correct. B, January 2020, Supreme Court told Department of Information Technology and Department of Telecom that you have to come back and give us the review. It's still not done. So this is something that, and Jammu and Kashmir should not think that we have forgotten you. Believe me, every time I get on something, I feel guilty that we are leading normal lives and people in Kashmir are living like this. This is absolutely, I mean, you know, we're fighting for this. And by putting pressure on the Department of Telecom, who keep passing the buck to the Home Ministry? Everyone keeps passing the buck. That's not on. It's not on. There has to be an oversight mechanism. And we have to know how many times you are increasing this, in what zones. You can't just blanket and cut off 4G access or 3G access. And we had an MP, and I'm naming him, Mr. Dubey, who said that, oh, I went to Jammu Kashmir on holiday, everyone's got 2G, everybody's happy. I mean, what are we talking about? We complain when we can't do a video call if we don't have 4G at home, and we are saying an entire state has got 2G, they should be happy. Since when has it become okay to have things like this? This is what the BJP has legitimized today. They have legitimized that some people, it is okay for some people to have less than the others. And that is the biggest damage they have done this country, which we must fight against.
Would you also say that the mainstream media has also been compromised in the same way, that it's easier for them to do business if they toe the line?
Of course. Of course, I pointed this out. I mean, 5 of the biggest media houses all controlled by one man, directly or indirectly. I mean, what are we talking about? When I write an article, I can't get anyone apart from The Wire to publish it. Now, you can say what I'm writing is so bad that nobody wants to read it, hence nobody. But if I'm writing is definitely, even if it's mediocre, it's better than a lot of rubbish that's put out there. And I can't get a mainstream newspaper to publish it. Every editor will call me back and say, madam, we're thinking about it. We're not sure. We've got this. We've got that. I mean, it's obvious, right? Apart from a couple of people on the internet, nobody apart from Vadarajan and The Wire and probably NDTV, nobody else is publishing anything right now. Nobody. So, of course, the media is compromised. I mean, you've only got to switch on your TV to realize how far we've gone. It's amazing.
Well, Ms. Moitra, we've run out of time, and I know that you have another appointment as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much,
for this conversation.
Thank you.
Thank you.